found parking. So we're going to just start with some introductions. I am Jessica Coleman. I'm the Intensive Services Coordinator for Children's Mental Health Services here at Howard Center and at NFI. There's a slide later about what that means and what I do so that you know.
Hi, and I'm Julie Tanguay. I'm the Director of Student Support Services at Colchester Middle School, and I facilitate multiple Act 264 meetings throughout the year. So Jess asked if I would come and maybe answer any questions, particularly as it relates to kind of the education piece inside of it.
Yeah, great. So I was just hoping to get a sense of who's in the room. So we'll just do it quickly. If people want to just say your name and what agency you're with, your title, and then any burning questions that you want to make sure get covered. I've been doing this a while, so I've kind of gotten most of them, but if there's anything you want to make sure I cover, I'll make a note of that. So I think I'll start over here.
I'm Siobhan Harber, school counselor at SSD school. And I don't have any burning questions, just wanting to learn about the whole process and everything we need to consider in planning.
Great.
Director of Support Services for the DC, and I'm also the Act 264 Partnership, and I'm here as kind of support with one of our special educators to get more people trained.
Mm-hmm. Steve Hockey, I'm a special educator at JFK Elementary in Winooski.
I'm Sasha Singer, I'm a clinician at Jarrett House, and I'm new to Vermont, so I'm excited to learn the process.
Great.
I'm
a family counselor with IFBS here at Howard Center.
Hi, I'm Matt Guyed, school counselor, South Burlington Middle School.
Great. Awesome. Thanks, everyone. This is my bigger training, so this is awesome. So the agenda today is just that I'm going to do
a little brief couple slides on the history behind Act 264, why it was created. I'm going to go through the components of Act 264. You have a whole Act 264 Coordinated Service Plan packet, and we're going to go through it page by page, so you'll know all the details of how to fill it out and what to do with it, and what to do after the paperwork's finished. My main goal is really to, I feel like there's this perception that Act 264s are kind of scary. Julie and I were just kind of talking about that, and I want to demystify that, that it's really pretty straightforward. You don't have to be kind of scared. I want you to leave feeling comfortable and ready to run a meeting. So I'm hoping that that's what you guys get out of it. So please feel free to ask questions as we go through. You don't have to save them for the end, so whenever they come up. Does that sound good? Great. So Act 264, it was actually created in 1988. It came out of a response in the 70s and 80s. There were kids with these large teams of providers. Usually it started kind of in the medical world, so a lot of different providers, all doing kind of different things, not totally cohesively, clearly pretty frustrating to families and children and parents. So Act 264 was created with the intention for it to be really child-centered and family-focused. You'll hear that theme kind of throughout, really kind of putting the family first, having their voice be heard. This is also a big important piece of it. It's an entitlement to a plan. It's an entitlement to a coordinated plan. It is not an entitlement to services or funding. I think that's a misperception out there that you have an Act 264 and you're going to get all these services. You're going to get people to look into these services and kind of work towards those things, but you're not guaranteed to get those things. It's also a process that provides multiple agencies to communicate, identify the strengths and the gaps for a kid, and to plan those services cohesively. So it really, there's a lot of plans out there that different providers have, and the goal is to have this one kind of centralized plan. So the actual act, it created an interagency definition of severe emotional disturbance. There's a slide later that kind of outlines what that means. It also created the actual coordinated service plan packet and the paperwork. It created the LIT team, which stands for the local interagency team. And there's 12 of those across our whole state. And we'll talk a little bit more about LIT. It also created the SIT team, which is the state interagency team. And that is the team that's above LIT that kind of is the next higher up the chain if you need that next level. And we'll talk a little bit about that. I have an example of some cases. It also created a governor-appointed advisory board. It's a body of people that kind of oversee the themes and stuff throughout the whole state. And again, throughout the whole thing, it emphasizes parent involvement and parent voice. So the actual components of the law. So it requires collaboration of multiple agencies in developing this coordinated service plan. So those multiple agencies are education, mental health, and DCF, Department for Children and Families. So this will come up again, but a lot of times people say, so if you don't have all those people at the table or at the meeting, it means it doesn't count as an Act 264. That's not true. It's really, you just have to make sure you offer that all those players come to the table, or that you invite all those players to the table, but if they can't come, it doesn't mean it's not an Act 264. There's nothing that kind of stamps and says, this is now an Act 264. It's more of make sure you include or invite all those people. The other really major component is that it requires that parents give permission. So parents or guardians, whomever that is. So there's a release section and we'll go over it, but it requires that parents sign off and say that they give permission for this meeting to happen and for all the right players to be invited to the table. It entitles the parents or the guardians to have and get a copy of the coordinated service plan. I say the 2009 version on there because there's a few 2007 versions floating around still out there. And I'm trying to weed those out and make people delete those. So the 2009 version is the one you have in your packet, and then they gave you some links to it. The reason for this is that if DCF is ever involved in a case and they need a copy of an Act 264, they cannot accept the 2007 version. So you want to just make sure, so you don't have to do all kinds of copying. Just make sure you do the 2009 version. The other components are that it requires that a coordinated service plan be completed prior to a residential placement. We'll go over that a little bit later, but it's an essential part of the process. It also gives you access to LIT and SIT. And then it also added the Act 264 Advisory Board and the access team. So this is where I'll talk a little bit about LIT and SIT. So LIT is a community team that reviews Act 264s that are kind of more complicated. When we talk about specific examples, I'll talk about one, but it's a body where teams and families can go to if they have some further kind of confusion after an Act 264 meeting or kind of issues or disagreement. And then if that continues to be the case, there's still disagreement or confusion, then it keeps moving up to SIT. And then the access team is another community team we have here in Chittenden County. They're kind of like the policy arm. They review themes, and they're just another body in our community, just so you know, that's always looking at trends in our community, gaps in our services across agencies, and they gather and collect all that data. So really the goal of Act 264, again, it's that interagency collaboration and planning, interagency kind of pooling of resources, whether that's financial or kind of otherwise, and then the interagency service development. Any questions so far? That's kind of the background. Okay. So the big question, when to have an Act 264 and who is eligible? So the actual wording is that if a child has a severe emotional disturbance or who meets the eligibility requirements for emotional disturbance under special ed, and they have multiple players or providers already on their team, and their needs are kind of bubbling and not being met, you'd have an Act 264. That's kind of jargony.
And if I could
yeah.
The state special ed regulations
yeah.
around when you find a student eligible for special education under the category of emotional disturbance that you need to make the parents aware that they do have a right to a coordinated
right.
service plan.
Right.
And I think that's something that people often kind of forget or don't think about.
So do you guys, like if a kid is eligible and you find them eligible under emotional disturbance for an IEP, do you in practice should be offering that as a special educator? Is that how that works?
Yeah, in practice, I think that you should be making parents aware.
Okay.
I think the reality is that it doesn't, people don't, that isn't the first thing that people always think of. And,
right.
You know, and there are some other criteria around, you know, the need for services and that kind of stuff. But I do oftentimes remind people when things are starting to bubble up and they're like, oh, the student, we feel like they're not getting the treatment that they need outside of here or things are impacting and kind of remind them like, hey, this, you know, this student is eligible as a student with an emotional disturbance and, you know, you can talk to the parent about their right to ask for a coordinated service plan.
Right. Okay. Yeah, Michelle.
Do all children who have an Act 264 meeting and an IEP have an ED IEP? Or
no.
Can they have a regular?
They can have an IEP for any other disability category, yes. Yep. No, the difference here is just that if a kid has ED as their primary disability category, then special educators have to offer that, if I'm saying the right language.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think what she's asking is it doesn't mean if they don't have the ED criteria,
yeah.
do they not,
nope.
can you not do an
yeah.
Act 264?
What I usually say is if a kid is having struggles somewhere, they're eligible. Like, that's it. It's that easy.
Right, so a child doesn't need to have an IEP to have two.
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Nope. Any kid that's struggling somewhere,
yeah. okay.
they qualify. Mm-hmm. That's really that easy.
I would add that it would bring to question if a kid was at the level that they were requiring coordinated
mm-hmm.
services between mental health and DCF,
yeah.
that you probably should be asking that question, does
mm-hmm.
the student
mm-hmm.
have a disability, whether
right.
it be under 504 or special ed.
Yeah.
But typically that might raise some questions around their
right.
mental health status and do they have a disability that they should be getting other types of protections
mm-hmm. right.
for.
Exactly. So, I mean, I often think about, like, in what does this mean in, like, real life? So I think about I've been to meetings where kids have maybe they had a recent assessment either through crisis or they've had a recent kind of evaluation or assessment by a psychologist. And there are some recommendations that came out of that, and the team's like, we don't know what to do with these. That might be a time to have an Act 264. It's that idea of there's some needs that this kid clearly has that our team right now doesn't know how to address. Let's pull together an Act 264. That might be an example. Sometimes people have Act 264s and kids are having like a pattern of crisis or a pattern of like placements out of the home. That might be a time to say, hey, there's something going on. Let's pull the team together and kind of do some brainstorming. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think it can be used in a way to kind of highlight for everyone and really have everyone looking at the same problem to say, this is really, this is what we're all identifying as a problem and or the needs. And again, the parents can choose to do what they want with it, but it's a way that everyone's on the same page about what the issues are. Yeah, certainly, if the parent will agree. Yeah.
But you need the parents' written permission.
Correct.
Start, right?
Yeah, you do. I think the other times to do an Act 264, if you haven't done one in like a year, a couple years, sometimes it's helpful to pull back together, revisit what you guys talked about a year ago or more, review kind of what was talked about. And then another time I feel like I've seen Act 264s done is it's a way to bring DCF to the table. I mean, otherwise, we don't usually just invite a DCF worker to a team meeting. It's a way to kind of formally invite DCF to come to a meeting to talk about a kid and any child welfare concerns if it's kind of, that's what's going on. Are there other examples that people might think of that they've run across of when they've seen?
Sometimes when you have a transition of a kid from one program to another,
yep.
One school to another.
Yeah. Yep, that's a nice way to kind of start fresh in terms of like reviewing what a kid's needs are. Yeah, that's definitely one.
So just DCF is a partner in this process regardless of if the child has an open case or investigation with them.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get resistance from parents around that if DCF hasn't been involved before with the family?
Oh yeah, definitely.
They get really nervous.
They get
very
nervous.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And all of DCF except these two lovely ladies got out of the training, I guess. I tried to get my usual DCF trainer here and it's oh, there you go. That's awesome. I appreciate you being here. So Steve McLaughlin usually does, or Anita Thomason, both of them do the training with me. And what they usually say is, like, Steve will say, I'm not at a meeting to take a report. I'm not at a meeting to, like, take notes of all the things that I'm hearing. I'm here to be a partner and another person at the table that can come up with ideas. They will, like when you put the request to DCF for the meeting, they will look in their system to see if they know a family, but they're not gonna come to the table with all that information, and they're certainly not coming to the table to make a report. If they know a family or they have an open case, clearly they're gonna try and send that worker or that previous worker if they can. That doesn't always happen, but I know that they try to do that. Yeah. I will say that as soon as parents hear DCF as one of the players, they will often say no. That definitely happens. And that doesn't mean you can't move forward with the meeting. You just have to offer that DCF is a resource. If they don't want it and they still sign, you can still move forward with the meeting and you don't have to invite DCF. It's totally fine. It's still called an Act 264 meeting. Does that make sense?
Yep.
I think people sometimes are like, it wasn't really a meeting. We didn't, and it's fine. No one's stamping it saying it is. It is.
They
absolutely.
For
yeah.
Everybody.
I mean, I think there's certainly cases where the team feels like DCF should be at the table because there's some child welfare concerns or there's some kind of unmanageability concerns, mm-hmm. that it's helpful to have DCF's perspective on what's going on. But again, it's always up to the parents if they want it or not. Yeah. The last little note is just that wanting to be really thoughtful that Act 264s are proactive versus in a crisis response. I understand that that does not always happen, but theoretically, best practice is that you are getting ahead of things. Like if you're starting to see that things are going south and people are kind of not sure what to do and you have some unmet needs, have an Act 264. Crisis happens and people need a change in services or kind of they need something different, and yes, people will have one if they're in placement like a Jarrah House or whatever.
I think an example that I can think of that I think is coming up more and more frequently for people is kids that are chronically truant,
mm-hmm.
and are saying because of mental health issues, because of
right.
anxiety, because of other types of things. And that has been helpful as a school, from the school perspective. The parents and everyone are often coming to the school like, what are you going to do? I can't get my kid to school. And it kind of can feel overwhelming as an educational institution because you're like, well, you know, we're trying to work with the family. We're offering alternatives, flexibility, like all kinds of things. And I have found that calling the Act 264 helps bring the other agencies in,
right.
like, hey, DCF, you do need to be aware this kid has not been to school in 30, 40 days. Like, mental health, they do need some help because this child is not leaving the home. And I think that I'm imagining is, and I know from talking to other people, that's not just a Colchester thing, that's
right.
increasing in frequency, you know, everywhere that those instances are coming up. So
yeah.
I would encourage, that's a good reason to call
yeah.
an Act 264 team together.
I would agree, that's certainly an issue that's on the rise in my perspective as well, yeah. So do people feel like I have a handle on like when you might think about an Act 264 or kind of talk it through with someone? Okay. So this is the actual definition of that the Act 264 made for severe emotional disturbance. It is that when a child exhibits a behavioral, emotional, or social impairment that disrupts his or her academic or developmental progress or in family relationships, impaired functioning for at least a year or short and high severity, and that the child or youth is under 18 years of age or under 22 if they're special ed eligible. I have not seen many Act 264s for kids or youth over 18. They certainly happen at that point. If the youth is their own guardian, they'd have to sign the paperwork themselves. It does happen, because those kids are, or youth are still being served sometimes in schools and by our services, so.
Just do all those criteria have to be met? So I'm looking specifically at the one in the middle, that the duration.
Yeah,
is
and again.
A year or of high acuity.
I think it's all also relative. I mean, again, I usually just say, if you have a kid that's struggling and they're not like doing well in some setting, done, check, they're eligible. I mean, I think, again, it's the idea of, are they struggling and there's people are stuck and they don't know what to do with it? Have an Act 264, yeah.
I've never had a situation where someone has like called a team and somebody else is then questioned,
right.
Like, you know, I don't, I don't really think this kid is eligible for this meeting.
Right, no, I haven't either. So who can request the meeting and who is the lead agency? So really anyone can request the meeting. It's usually parent or guardian, might be some people from education, might be someone from mental health, a treatment provider, DCF can. We have parent reps through Vermont Family Network. If the parent's connected with them, they might say, hey, sounds like you should have an Act 264 meeting. Other agencies that are getting more knowledgeable of Act 264s are post-adoption, so Lund, and then developmental services. They are starting to do quite a few more Act 264 meetings as well. So there's this perception out there that there's like clear-cut criteria for kind of like who is the lead agency and who organizes the meeting. And in the kind of written regulations, it doesn't kind of read that way. So in 2005, there was an interagency agreement at the state level, and it ensured that, it just says, it ensures all required services are coordinated and provided to students with disabilities. So it just, it gave some guidelines, so this best practice for kind of who is lead agency. So who or what specific agency or person has the most expertise to understand the primary needs and concerns of the child, which case manager has the strongest relationship with the family, and who is the family asking for or prefer to lead the meeting? So again, it's back to that family voice and their comfort level, really. People out there, this is the old standard used to be that, oh, the kid has a mental health provider, they have to be lead. Oh, the kid is in special ed and they're struggling at school, education has to be the lead. Or DCF has custody, that means DCF has to be the lead. It doesn't read that way. There are certainly people out there that are gonna quote that to you when they say, oh, they're not struggling here, you do the meeting. And I really encourage all of you to kind of take this message forward around what does the family want? Who are they asking to lead the meeting? And also if they're asking the school and the school's saying, and I'm just not meaning to throw school people under the bus, I'm just, they're saying they're not struggling here, someone else do it, you could partner and say, let's do this together. Or I'm hearing the family say they want you to lead it, you know? So it's more of a collaborative conversation than a black and white, this is who leads it. Does that make sense to people? I will say, I think the primary people that get asked are mental health providers, like school social workers, or if there's any in-home services. And obviously, I think a lot of special educators run a lot of Act 264 meetings as well.
I run a lot of them.
Yes, you do.
As a director of support services,
right.
I do quite a few.
Right.
And I think it varies. Like, I have kids out at alternative placements, and there are times, well, you've been at some of my meetings, Jess, where I'm running them because I know the family really well, and
right.
even though the child might be placed at Belcate, we have a long-standing relationship. And then there are times where I could have a student at another school where you know, we're even considering residential down the road, and there's a high level of mental health involved already, and they might take the lead,
right.
but I'm right there, you know, or we do a lot school-based,
right.
As you were saying, where it could be the special educator or the team really knows the kid well.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the biggest thing is that collaboration.
Right.
That it doesn't matter who takes the lead. The important thing is that everybody is working together.
Right.
And I think, too, lead doesn't necessarily mean the facilitator either.
Right.
So there are times when the lead agency of record might be mental health, because maybe mental health is looking to do some type of out-of-home placement,
right.
or something where they're like, hey, we really need to get this team. And it may not be that, you know, education may be feeling like, hey, we've got a great wraparound, we're not really having those same issues.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean that someone from education might not facilitate the meeting,
right.
even though mental health is sort of the lead agency of record,
right.
because oftentimes the people at the school are the people that have the closest relationship with the families and the student, and
right.
And kind of are the keeper sometimes of that central information.
Right.
If you have a family in crisis and there's more than one child, is it ever done as more
yeah,
than
we're
one?
Gonna talk,
yeah,
we're
going
to talk.
Yeah,
that
there's
right?
a slide
okay.
later, because, yeah,
okay.
that's coming up a lot more, the either family or sibling Act 264. So, yeah, that's becoming more prevalent. So,
can you just clarify the difference between who leads and who facilitates?
Yeah, that's the next slide. Oh, wait. Give me two slides. So we'll start with who should be invited, and then it'll be kind of what does the lead agency do. So someone says, hey, I think we're going to have an Act 264. You kind of start with who you're going to invite, who should come. So parents and caregivers, obviously, they should come. They also have to sign off on the meeting happening. I have had an instance of a meeting where they were like, oh, well, mom can't actually come. Should we go ahead? And I was like, no. It doesn't make, like, she has a central piece of information and knowledge and expertise, and that doesn't make sense to move forward. You'd have a gap in information. So I always think parents and caregivers have to be there, and if they can't, you reschedule, I think. Education, someone from education also has to be invited. If the kid's in special ed, obviously some kind of special ed rep. Sometimes it's teachers, sometimes guidance counselors, principals, nurses. I will say, and I'm interested to hear Julie's perspective, that if you're going to have, I have seen sometimes schools invite like whole masses of people, and you got like six people from the school. That's kind of a lot. You might want to think about who really needs to be at the meeting. I don't know that all six people need to come to the meeting, principal, assistant principal, you know, that kind of thing. I think it's just three top people, but it just can make the meeting pretty large and cumbersome if you have. And scary, I think, too, if you think about being family-centered, if you got, like, six people from the school showing up. But I don't know if you guys have any perspective on that.
Yeah, no, I mean, we typically would have someone from administration,
right.
whether myself or it, depending on kind of how
yeah.
high up it is, maybe Carrie from the district level,
yeah.
the special educator if there's one, and, you know, potentially the guidance counselor if
right.
they are working.
We
often don't have classroom teachers there. One, for that reason, it can kind of be overwhelming. It's not really a parent-teacher conference. And two, the meetings often are a pretty large chunk of time, and it can be difficult logistically to sort of get a student's, you know, whole team of teachers out of classes for that long.
Yeah. So other people to invite are DCF. So if there's an open case, or there's custody, obviously there's an assigned worker and they should be invited to the meeting. The way that you invite an Act 260 or a DCF rep, you have it in your packet. So you have the Act 264 partnership list. It does need to be updated. There are certainly people on this list that don't work anymore. But I think the major, so it's mostly education. There's a few education people that have moved around a little or in different districts. I think the major pieces are the very top you'll see to invite a DCF rep, you contact Susan Akey Giles. So she is the main point of contact for DCF. Usually she likes about 2 weeks out. You call her with a meeting date and time. She puts it out to the different teams and they see who can attend.
I'm just gonna reinforce that because
Yes.
The other emails that are lifted for other supervisors, that's gonna be shipping, so it's exactly, yeah, Sue's the one to be.
Absolutely. And her email is also, her phone number's on the top, but her email is also on the bottom, because she will ask for you, the next page, to fill out this Act 264 questionnaire. So this allows some basics of information to go to the DCF worker so they have some context.
And I would add in here too, and this is, you know, we all know that, you know, DCF, like everyone else, is overwhelmed and
busy.
Shorthanded. So don't be afraid though to really, if this is a case where you need to have a DCF worker there,
mm-hmm.
you need to be insistent and press that issue.
Right.
And stress the importance, because
right.
it can be challenging sometimes to get all the players and coordinate, but
right.
if it's one that you really feel that they need to be there, then you need to stress to them that you're gonna work the meeting around when they can be there, and
right.
you may have to call a couple times.
Right. And Susan gets that.
She's been bugged a lot by a lot of us.
So part of the reason you need parent permission is because you're releasing some information about this kid to DCF. So that release covers you to send these basics of information to DCF to get them to the meeting and give them some context. So she will ask for you. This is all saved in our at Howard Center, but you guys all have copies of this now too. She will ask for this information when you make a request. So you also.
Yes, I'm sorry. And did you say that you need to get a release ahead of time from mom or dad?
Yes, so that'll be covered. But yes, the
talk,
release is
so.
In the paperwork.
Okay.
Yes. Sometimes if you just talk with a parent and you get verbal permission, you can do that too. That's fine. So the other pieces of other people to invite, all mental health requests, for those of you who are not mental health providers in the room, all those requests go through first call. So if there isn't someone attached through mental health, either from Howard Center or NFI, those are the two agencies where who can serve as reps for Active 64s, then you go through first call. And you call first call with the date and the time, and they send it out to our partnership list. And then if you want anyone from developmental services, if there's some developmental services needs, Delana Norton is also on the top. And so she does intake over at developmental services, and she puts it out to her team if they can attend a meeting. So other people to invite, a parent rep, that is through Vermont Family Network. They are also on our contact list if the parent wants someone who, these are parents who have gone through the process, they have children of their own that have kind of gone through this process, so they have expertise in knowing what it feels like, so they can offer that support to parents. So other people to consider, whoever kind of makes sense on the team, if there's a post-adopt worker. Sometimes you'll get people from the doctor's offices. Some of the nurse coordinators will come. I have had pediatricians come to meetings if they're really involved. Sometimes you have people from economic services or housing or whoever makes sense. But you want to be also thoughtful about the size of the meeting. So again, who needs to be there? Who has information? Who can be part of the planning process?
Pediatrician or a therapist,
right,
to kind of pre-plan a time when they can call into the meeting.
Right.
So they might not be able to block off a whole like 2 hours, but they might be able to say, hey, I can be on the phone with you from 9:30 to 10. And we just kind of,
right.
you know, establish that ahead of time that, hey, when they get on the phone,
right.
if there are specific things that we really want to get their input on,
yep.
you know, we kind of plan around that.
Yeah. No, and I feel like that's increasing, I think, with more kind of nurse or social worker people in doctor's offices, they've been more available. Yeah. Yeah, Michelle.
Should psychiatrists be included?
If they can be, I think psychiatrists and therapists are two providers that can be tricky to get to meetings based on their schedules. And also payment can be an issue sometimes. There's not really payment to kind of pay consultation and stuff for those people to come to meetings, so sometimes they can and sometimes they can't. So sometimes what you can do is whoever's leading the meeting or who one of the case managers could just get an update from that person and their perspective, and you can bring that to the meeting. I think the other thing to consider is whether you invite the child or not. Certainly this is more relevant to teenagers, But I think it's pretty valuable and can be really valuable to either have them fill out the paperwork before with a trusted adult and have that shared, or have them come for part of the meeting. There's a lot of studies out there around kind of the importance of youth engagement. Like, if they're a part of their plan and their voice is in the plan, it's shown to improve outcome. So however you want to include the youth, the voice in the meeting. I mean, I'll be in meetings even for like an 8-year-old, and when you're in the goals section, I'll say, what does so-and-so want for themselves? And they'll like, they'll say something silly, like, I want to go to Disney. But you're like, that's great. Like, that's future-oriented. Let's talk, you know. Just include the voice of the youth and the family as much as you can.
Probably pretty powerful for them to see also the amount of people that are at the table and care and don't want to help them.
Mm-hmm. Right, absolutely. So, it, again,
overwhelmed.
Yeah, I think you got to judge for the yourself with the kid.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's really kid dependent.
Yeah, I've certainly had teens blow out of meetings. But as, if you know the kid, or if you're the trusted adult, you can sit with them, or, you know, read their cues when they're ready to leave. I think it can be important.
And you can also plan for them to also be just at a certain
mm-hmm.
part of the meeting.
Right.
Which I've been at Act 264, is where a kid
right.
comes in, so it's not super overwhelming, but they're able to
yeah.
meet their team, kind
right.
of, and see their whole team and say some of their point of view, and then they can leave.
Right. Right. And in particular, I think we'll go through this, but like the first section is the goals and hopes. That's a great time. Versus when you get to the needs and you're talking about all the things that are not going well, that's hard, obviously. So maybe having them exit before then. Yeah. So just a quick word about the partnership list that has all the list of kind of DCF reps and the mental health and education. They are really there to just provide kind of support and resources at the meeting. Their role is not to facilitate meetings. Sometimes people feel like they're going to call up Mary Ellen Woods on the partnership list, and she's going to run and lead that meeting. And while she can do that, that's not the intention of this. The intention is to support you in leading the meeting and answer any questions. Maybe she could be the note taker, or so-and-so could do, you know, different tasks. But when you're calling people on the partnership list, they are not there to run your meeting. They are there to support you and understand the process, just so you know. The parent rep also from on here, we have Connie and Janice. They're the two Vermont Family Network parent reps. They sometimes just talk to parents before meetings. They can come to the meeting and support the parents, sit with them, answer questions before and after, just as a support however the parent wants. Some parents are like, no, fine, I don't want that, and that's fine too.
They're really excellent.
Yeah. Right, they're very kind and supportive. So the lead agency's responsibilities. So the lead agency responsibilities are to schedule and facilitate the meeting. Again, you can farm things out to other people, but
that might kind of speak to your question.
Right.
So like an example might be
yeah.
where we might identify mental health as the lead agency. I might be working with a school social worker. We might agree that mental health is really sort of the primary driver for this meeting, but yet I might be the one that actually facilitates the meeting when
right.
we're there.
Right. So then the other responsibilities are that you are the one that's writing up the coordinated service plan and then distributing it to team members, ensuring that the plan is regularly reviewed. It's really whoever might be kind of identified as primary. So again, who the parent identifies, whether it's a special educator or school social worker, you're the one that's kind of completing the paperwork, turning it into the right people, checking in about whether things are getting done. After you distribute it, sometimes there's some questions around what was written. That doesn't happen that often, but if you want to adjust anything. I think this next point is super important because I think this is still a perception out there that whoever is lead agency automatically pays for funding. That is absolutely not true. The lead agency is not automatically responsible for funding or providing the services identified. They are merely the person that is coordinating the whole team to talk about what you want to pursue next, like what do we want to explore, what referrals do we want made. It is not attached to any financial responsibility whatsoever. I want to emphasize that. I think people are still scared. I know that there are still people and agencies in our state and in our county that say, I'm not running the meeting because it means I'll have to provide the service or I'll have to pay for blah, blah, blah. And that is not true.
Can I just add one other thing? Another thing that I think is really important is to differentiate between the Act 264 and the IEP meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So things like decisions around placements at alternative day schools and all of those things, those can't be decided there.
Right.
A team can say, you know, we think there should be an IEP meeting where that would, where people look at that.
Right.
But sometimes people come and think that you can make educational decisions around the IEP. You can say that there should be an IEP meeting, and but just...
And that's our next slide, because
yeah.
that comes up a lot.
It comes up a lot.
So I just want to emphasize one last thing. So, again, mental health may be identified as the lead. It doesn't mean you can't say, hey, Julie, can you run the meeting for me? I'll take notes. Or the parent rep comes and you say, hey, can you be my timekeeper? You know, like those kind of things. So you can definitely... work together, but whoever's kind of identified as lead is kind of the main person kind of just deciding who's going to do what, but you're really the one that's going to make sure that it happens, it gets scheduled, and the paperwork gets done. And it's your question, Vanessa? Okay. So this is the big thing that comes up a lot is how is an Act 264 meeting different from like a treatment team meeting or even an IEP meeting or any other number of meetings that we have? So the similarity is they have some similar players. You have a team, so that those people that are already on the team should be coming to your Act 264 meeting. But Act 264 meetings might have some other players that come in, like a consultation role. DCF might come as a consultation role. I might come as a consultation role. Someone from some other service you're thinking about might come, or you might have a parent rep or that kind of thing. But the goals are what's different. The goal of an Act 264 meeting is to create the coordinated service plan. That is your agenda. That's all you're doing. It is not a treatment team meeting. Act 264 meetings happen. You write the coordinated service plan, and then that coordinated service plan goes to your team, who should be meeting regularly and implementing and doing that plan. So they're the ones in about a month that should pull out that document again and say, hey, what'd we talk about? Let's check in about what's going on with all the things we just identified. So the treatment team is the ongoing, regular team communication that is implementing this plan. Does that make sense to everyone? So there's a lot of other teams, just like Robin said. So you have the Act 264 team. You also have an IEP team. Might have similar players again, but very different charges. I don't know if Julie, you want to talk a little bit about kind of just a little bit, emphasize a little more what Robin said.
Speaking to what Robin said, we do try to say, like at the beginning of the meeting, the piece around that this meeting, it does not guarantee services, especially if a kid's on an IEP, and sometimes there have been questions prior to the Act 264, parents asking about placement and other kinds of services. So we do try to clarify for them that the Act 264 meeting is not the place where we would be talking about those kind of placement.
Because legally, you guys have to do it as part of your whole warning and IEP meeting and all that kind of stuff.
Right, yeah, and there's a whole piece around least restrictive environment and placement and services and those kind of things. So things that come up in the Act 264 might be things that an IEP team might consider when they're meeting, but things that are in an Act 264 plan are very different than services that are guaranteed legally to a parent in an IEP. And I think that's one of the
right.
big differences is that you can talk about a lot of things at an Act 264 meeting, but nothing in there is legally
right.
guaranteed to a parent. At an IEP team meeting, if the team decides to put something in the services and that's in the IEP, it's legally binding and,
right.
and guaranteed for that student and family.
Yeah, so what I often will do in meetings is if it's starting to say like they're raising a lot of questions around school services or education placements or whatever, we'll say, all right, one of the proposed agenda items is have an IEP meeting. That's the place where all of that decision making can happen. There's lots of other meetings out there, care conferences and discharge meetings and case review meetings. Again, they all have their own different charges and agendas. The Act 264 meeting is really just creating the coordinated service plan. Is that clear? That makes sense? Awesome. So now we're going to go through the coordinated service plan. So you will see on here that so you have your own blank copy, but I also have on here the different places you can find it on the internet. through Vermont Family Network, through Department of Mental Health. And then on the bottom for those Howard Center staff, you can see where you can find another blank one. So I'm just gonna have us look at section one. So the majority of the time, I don't know, 75-85% of the time, you are only doing section one. The rest of the packet is if you're pursuing residential treatment. We'll talk about that. But so most of the time, you're just gonna pull out section one. So you really only have to print section one. You don't have to print the rest of it if you're not looking forward to any residential placements. So when you open it, you'll see the first page has a little bit about kind of just the overview, what the different parts of it. Page two is where you start seeing those consents and releases for the parent to sign. So you'll see the parent and guardian. This first page is about eligibility. That's kind of what we talked about. If a kid is struggling, they have needs, done, they're eligible. This one's pretty easy. You can just say that to the parent and they sign and date. The next page is the release of information. This is what you need so you can coordinate the meeting. This is why you should be doing this before you're sitting around the table with everybody you just invited. Because technically you need the release to do that. You may have gotten verbal permission. Obviously that I understand that. But one of my big things is really trying to be thoughtful, again, and parent focused. If you're talking about an Act 264, you should be sitting down with the parents with this paperwork a week before the meeting, 2 weeks before the meeting, signing the paperwork and saying, here's what I'm gonna do next. I'm gonna invite so-and-so and so-and-so, and here's the information I'm gonna give them so that they're ready for the meeting. So that's best practice. I know that it doesn't always happen that way, but we should be trying for that. You'll see on both these two releases, there's the little checkbox that say, I wanna speak with my local interagency team's parent rep. That's where you offer for them to speak with the Vermont Family Network staff. They don't have to. They can say no, and that's totally fine, but you really have to offer. You have to offer, say, hey, I can give you the Vermont Family Network phone number. Let me know if you want that. So you should be checking yes or no. The next box, or the next page, page four, after you get releases, is the kind of background demographics information. You can do this in the meeting. Doesn't really matter. It's just basic info. Karen?
Just real quick, sorry. Where's the family network number that you're offering to the parent?
I usually just Google it.
I can't tell you off the top of my head.
Okay.
Oh, and is it on there?
It should be on there.
Is it on the partnership list?
Yeah.
I usually sit in the meeting and Google it. It's probably on there.
Yeah, it gives the number under the parent. Connie,
yeah, there's Connie and Janice's.
That's
yep.
The number you're talking about.
You can give them one of those. Yep. Yes. Yeah, you can just give them, or you can give them the general number too, or you can give them one of the specific ones. So in terms of the background information, and just to kind of identify who's doing the paperwork, who's kind of lead on filling this out, basic demographics about the kid. I often use this bottom section, the team participants, as a sign-in sheet in the meeting. So you can just pass it around and have people fill it out. That way you know who's there and you don't fill it out yourself. And then, you know, sometimes in bigger meetings, yeah, another sheet of paper. Totally fine. You can do that. So then you're into, like, the bulk of the meeting. And again, this is your agenda. This is the only thing you are doing in your meeting. Some people are using, in your packet, you'll find this Act 264 meeting agenda. I will see some clinicians and special educators hand this out at the beginning of meetings as a way to set the stage. It talks about that, oh, we've done the releases, we've done introductions, we know who's here. It talks about kind of no funding attached to it, this. It talks about the purpose of our meeting and then what we're gonna do in terms of next steps. It can be a nice little handout for people to review. Do you guys have it?
Mm-hmm.
You guys are all shuffling around.
Yeah.
Keep holding it up. It's right before the evaluation. It's after the three sections.
Yes.
Great. So you could use this for yourself. You can also hand it out at the beginning of the meeting for people. Just sets the stage. So again, just to emphasize, the purpose of the meeting is to fill out the paperwork. I just lost mine, there it is. If you are starting to go off and do like 30, 40 minutes of updates and like different providers kind of reporting out, you're kind of going into a team meeting. You might want, like, whoever's facilitating might want to reel that in a little bit, you know? Like, really keep people focused on page 5, hopes and goals, moving into strengths, needs and challenges.
And I often will say that
yeah.
at the beginning of the meeting.
Right.
I will say, you know, my job as a facilitator, I know that sometimes in these team meetings, there's lots of things that people might want to talk
right.
about. However, we have a lot of things that we, you know, need to get through. So, you know, kind of to tell them, don't take offense, but I am going
right.
to keep us kind of on track and on task with the items that we need to. And,
right.
and that, I think that's the nice piece about this Act 264 that we said where it really isn't as daunting maybe as some people say, because it's very structured. You know, there's an outline for it. You just kind of follow the different steps and the format,
right.
and it's not difficult. To
right. This is your agenda, and you'll find sometimes if people start talking about a goal, you might lead into well, and they also like, but they don't do blah blah blah. You can like, as the notator, like make a note of that down in the needs section, but say we're actually just gently guide them back to we're still on hopes and strengths. Because I will tell you, you're there because the kid's struggling, and people will want to go right to that, like what everything that's not working, and what's nice is I think is starting with what are our hopes.
And just a matter of just a tip, and everybody kind of has their own way of how you're comfortable with the notes and that kind of stuff, so you don't have to do it this way, but what we find helpful is that we'll often, you know, preload kind of that demographics and any of that kind of stuff,
right.
and then as a facilitator, I'll have like chart paper up and I'll have that sort of pre-loaded with the topics, hopes and goals, needs and that kind of stuff.
Right.
And I'll have a second person at the table with their laptop and with the actual electronic copy of the Act 264. And so we would print out, we'd have the printed pages of the signature pages,
right.
but we have actually somebody there taking notes, and then I might give that person the chart paper after just to say, make sure you didn't forget anything. But that way, it's pretty much like done in the moment.
Right.
And the chart paper allows, though, everyone else to kind of see
right.
what we've talked about. We'll often, you know, post them so that we can easily kind of go
right.
back and forth.
Yeah, I think public notes are really important so that parents see what you're writing so they don't think you're writing something else.
We do the same thing. I agree, Julia. Really, it's nice because then at the end of the meeting, basically, we've typed what's up on the chart,
right.
and we're ready to print
right.
a
yeah,
plan.
Not a lot of
and you're not just doing a chart and then
right.
copying it in. But I agree with the public notes, because then you might have hopes and goals, and you might have other things, and the person that's doing the recording can say, oh, this really goes under here, and
right.
and everyone can see it versus someone just typing it and people hearing it.
Right, exactly. So again, I just want to emphasize that keeping it parent and family focus. So asking the parent or caregiver to give their information first. Some parents don't want to do that, want to hear what other people have to say, but offering that, say, we really want to hear what you have to say. What do you want for your child? And then moving through. Sometimes I've seen clinicians, again, when you sit with the parent before the meeting to do the signatures, they'll have parents kind of write out their thoughts beforehand. That's great. I think the idea is then to just say, oh, mom shared this with me. What do other people want to add? So then opening it up to the group after you share what mom may have shared before.
Well, and it's also helpful as a parent, because they may want to share it themselves,
right.
but to have time to actually think about it, they come to the meeting with notes. Because it can be overwhelming for them. Sometimes there's people at the meeting they haven't met before.
Right.
And, you know, to
right.
just be like, oh, now you need to tell us what all your hopes and goals are for your child.
Right.
They can feel a little put on the spot.
So the agenda, the bulk of it is these two pages on 5 and 6. So you're going through these three sections, and then you move into the current supports and then the proposed supports. This section E, proposed supports, you want to save some time for this, because this is where you're really doing the brainstorming and problem solving and thinking through kind of what do we, now that we've talked about all this, what do people think? And what do you think we should explore, and that kind of thing. Some people ask kind of, what do you normally budget for time for a meeting? I would say you can do it in an hour. I would generally say an hour and a half. If you are going up to 2 hours, you've kind of turned it into a little more of a team. Like, that's a little long. If you're doing the whole packet, I might do 2 hours. But I just, you want to keep people moving. You don't want to get stuck in certain sections. Because people can keep listing challenges. But is that productive? You know, you might want to think about that. But you want to make sure that you save time for this proposed section, because this is where you're writing, sounds like we should make a mentoring referral. And then really making sure you highlight and note who's responsible for this. Because I have many parents that say, I had that Actor 64 meeting and nothing happened. But if you identify, oh, look, the school social worker said she made that referral. Let's check in with her and see what happened with that. I actually have a couple samples that I'll pass around that I'll just go grab. But you can write in things here like explore therapeutic horseback riding. Like, you can write general things. It doesn't have to be a specific service. Like, oh, I'm going to make this referral, or I'm going to call this provider. It can be like
summer camps.
Right. Really general.
Mentoring, like,
right.
Things like that.
Right. And as long as you make a point person, then I think that is the main part of it. But it doesn't have to always be something really specific, like an agency or referral. I'm just going to go grab my samples. So I have two samples. They are blacked out. They are real people. Please don't try and read underneath the blacked out portions. I know that you won't, but I just want to make sure I say that.
Are there ever difficulties with filling in the current status and funding?
Yeah, and I have to say, I wouldn't get caught up in that.
Okay.
I mean, if funding's an issue, you want to make sure you kind of talk about how you're going to work that out. But if each column and each line isn't filled out, I don't think it's a big deal. I think it's more important in terms of, like, well, do we have the funding for this? And who's the point person for this? Those feel most important.
But remember, you're not guaranteeing anyone anything at that meeting. So it might be, we'll explore this. You could run into a barrier of,
right,
we couldn't find funding.
There's
for
no
it.
There's no funding, right. Exactly. And you'll see from the two, from the two examples, one is handwritten and one is typed. It doesn't really matter. I have done both. I am someone that usually, if I'm running a meeting, I'll just pull down all those sticky post-it things and lay them in my office and type them up. Or sometimes people just write into it in the meeting. You can really do either. It's okay. You can also do, I think it's important, you don't have to write paragraphs. You don't have to write a narrative. You can write bullet points. Totally fine. Doesn't matter, as long as the point gets across.
Yeah, I just want to go back to parental approval and all that.
Yeah.
In a case where students in DCF custody, and you've got DCF, and you've got a parent, and you've got a foster parent, and you've got an advocate.
Yeah.
Who has to take that role?
So whoever has custody of the child. So if it's DCF, it'd be DCF that has to sign off on it.
Yeah.
If you can still have the parent at the table, which is awesome, then obviously you're still really including them in all that decision making. Yeah. So the page 7, after you've kind of talked through what are our ideas, who's doing what, there's a crisis plan. You only have to fill this out if it makes sense. I think it's often, I will say, not done in meetings, because you might already have a crisis plan. Or maybe one of the action items is, at our next team meeting, make a crisis plan. You do not have to do one at the end of the meeting. It is not required. It's only if it makes sense and if it's a need for that child.
And I would encourage you to be thinking about that at the front end. So
right.
If you know, like, hey, we really do need to put a crisis plan on this, what we have going here.
Right.
You want to make sure you allot that time. And also, if there are people at the meeting that you know can only stay for a certain amount of time,
right,
and they're key to that crisis plan. Because I do find that's one thing that sometimes gets short-changed with the time, and you know, we're at the last 10 or 15 minutes trying to put together a crisis plan.
Right.
So if you want that, a lot time for it at
right.
the beginning.
Yeah, I will also often, as one of the action items that you identify, one of the proposed supports, I might say, create crisis plan with smaller group or at next team meeting or that kind of thing. Because not everyone needs to be, like, if I'm coming to the meeting as a consultant, I'm not usually going to stay for a crisis plan. I'm going to, so not everyone usually needs to be a part of that. So the next session, just we've talked a little bit about this, like some of the common pitfalls or things that you run into. I think the biggest thing.
Could I say one more thing about the crisis plan?
Yeah, please.
That I think is important is that if you do a crisis plan, and one of the benefits of it becoming part of the Act 264 is it then does become part of, like, you know, Howard Center and their system. So, like, if you then call first call would then know, like, oh, there's a crisis plan that's been put in place through the Act 264, and kind of have a little bit more information. So that is sort of one of the benefits to having that.
Yeah, absolutely.
As
yeah.
opposed to different from, like, a, you know, part of a school behavior plan or something like
right.
that.
Right, so whoever's lead on this can make sure that this information makes it to first call. So, you've probably picked up on this in us talking about the meetings, but I would say that one of the biggest things is just keeping the meeting on track. People will want to go down different kind of things, turn it more into a team meeting, or trying to do kind of IEP discussion. And as the facilitator, it is your number one goal to kind of manage that. So really, you know, it's what's nice is you have this paperwork to fall back on and say, oh, that's great conversation. Let's table that. Sometimes I'll have an extra sheet on the side that you call a parking lot and say, let's table that and put that in the parking lot for the next team meeting. But I want us to stay focused on this. This is what our agenda is today. You can always just fall back on the paperwork.
And I think that is, too, where sometimes being thoughtful about who your facilitator is. So
right.
if you have sort of the luxury of being able to get a facilitator that maybe is a little, you know, removed from the depth of the team, it's a little bit easier for them to kind of stay, for them not themselves to get, you know,
right.
bogged down in a conversation. So
yeah.
you don't always have that luxury, but sometimes,
yeah.
you know, for myself, sometimes I can play that role and the
right.
special educator is there in a different role.
Right.
And I think it's easier than her or him having to
right.
try to, like, redirect the team or tell the parent, like,
right.
hey, we're not going to have
exactly.
that conversation here.
Sometimes I've seen in meetings, and this is just a random example, but, like, having, like, say you know grandma's coming and grandma talks a lot. You might have someone kind of be sitting next to grandma and saying, oh, we're going to stay on track, you know, that's a great idea, but, you know, and that's just a random example, but, you know, that crowd management and keeping on task is a really big part. does someone have a question? It could be.
Yeah, it's a good question. It's a pretty general crisis plan
yeah.
in terms of, like, what are the things that trigger the student? What
yep.
are things to do? What are things not to do? So I find that most of the time it's fairly similar across environments. Like, if the kid has particular triggers,
mm-hmm.
you know, there might be certain things, like their younger brother or sister, that may not apply. But
right.
often the things that work for the kid in terms of these are things that they use to self-regulate, this is what we found we've had the most success with, these are the things, like, definitely do not do this when the
right.
kid is in crisis. It's typically similar,
mm-hmm.
and often doing this in that type of team meeting helps you to kind of have also bring the team together so that, hey, we're all responding the same way to this crisis, so that this kid knows that if he goes to this level or takes this step, then first call's called, regardless of whether it's home or school
right.
or, you know, this is what the response will be.
And there's certainly different, like, there very likely may be different responses in the school environment versus at home, but the idea of general triggers and stuff.
Michelle?
Let's say the child has had a placement with Jared.
Yep.
And they've written a crisis plan. Can we just bring that
yep.
with us and
mm-hmm.
make
yep.
copies?
Yep, totally. You could say, see attached.
Yeah.
Yep,
okay.
Definitely. Did that answer your question, Lisa? Okay. So other things, just really being thoughtful. Again, people will often want to jump into what's not working well. I mean, that's why you're having a meeting. So just trying in the hopes and goals section to really phrase things positively. I cannot emphasize enough the importance of having paperwork signed before meetings. Technically, you should get those releases before you start inviting all those people. Other pitfalls, not inviting the right team members to the table or those that have information that you would want. So being really thoughtful. Some people will want to rush and have a meeting. We're going to have it Wednesday. Well, can you get everyone you really want at the table? No. Should you have that meeting? Probably not. So people will feel urgency about having a meeting, but you also want to be really thoughtful about having people come that should be there. So maybe booking it out a week or so would make sense.
Yeah, and I often find you, it may take a couple
weeks. Oh, for sure.
Particularly if you're trying to get DCF, mental health, and everybody
right.
at the table.
So then there's the question of sibling and family Act 264 meetings. I know that I've started to run a few. I think, Julie, you are also starting to do. Do you have any kind of thoughts on how you usually run them? There's no protocol if people are kind of making it up.
Yeah. I mean, so oftentimes for a family, there are some similar, you know, concerns and issues. So what I've done in the past is, you know, we'll coordinate with the other school or the other agencies, and we'll make sure we have representatives from both. But we run it fairly similar. The difference being is I might have two people, you know, with their devices and in the actual plan. So we still would do two separate documents
right.
for the kids. And I would have I did one actually just 2 weeks ago.
Right.
And I had a chart paper, and I actually just put a line down
right.
it. So when we talked about hopes and goals, does this relate to this kiddo? Relates
right.
to this kiddo? If it was both of them, I, you know, would put
yeah.
like a little line saying, hey, this is common stuff in the middle. And then the note the note takers were like, oh, this is my stuff for this kid, and the other kid would make sure they're putting in stuff
yeah.
for them. It is helpful, I think, for a parent to be able to do it all together. Oftentimes the school people might be different, but the mental health people, DCF, is common for the family. So it's easier for them not to have to like kind of rehash and,
right.
and go through all of the other challenges
right.
multiple
times. Right, because sometimes the referral you're gonna make might include the whole family anyway. So if you're having a family that has three siblings and they're all struggling with different things, but you might be recommending the same kind of in-home service. Great to talk about.
Yeah,
all
I would
once.
Recommend the two documents if you can, though.
No, that's great.
Because that can be really hard to like, because then you get into issues of like we're putting this
whose file
stuff in somebody's file
right.
and all that kind of stuff. So
right.
it does helpful for each child to have their own
right.
plan, but you can do it simultaneously.
Yeah, and then I certainly have when I've run these meetings is. Because you're talking about multiple kids, you're definitely, these are longer meetings. They're usually 2 hours. I heard of one this week that was three, but they were doing a residential request as part of one of them, so it was very long. But just being thoughtful that you wanna be not rushing. If you're having a family Act 264, you're talking about a lot in that meeting, so you want more time. So most of the time, the paperwork stops here. That is the last section, unless you're doing a residential referral. So the idea is, whoever is compiling this paperwork, you are making sure it's all filled out, however you do it, electronically or writing it. You then, some people in the meeting have the capacity to print it off and provide copies. That doesn't have to happen, it can. You can then, I usually say, in about a week or so, make sure it's all compiled. And really making sure that when the copies you send to people have the signatures on it, because it's not useful. Like if I get a copy and I don't know that I actually have the signature page, I want to make sure my file has the same thing as everybody else. So in about a week, I usually say, you can get it out to the team members. Copies should go to everyone who participated in the meeting, including DCF. If they didn't come, you don't have to send them a copy. For Howard Center staff, you should also have a copy go into our health information file, so making sure that that happens. And
can I ask a question about that? Because I've more recently had the Howard staff or the mental health folks say, only send me page 4. Like they only want the documentation like that they were there or present.
I think
I've
that our file should have
times.
The whole thing. But sometimes, so this next section is that Betsy Kane, who's our assistant director here at Howard Center at CYFS, she tracks all of our meetings, so she takes page 4 for her copy. I wonder if that may be it.
Yeah, but I've had the person say, I only need page 4, I don't
okay.
need...
So if you're participating in a meeting, and you are, like, the kid is open to you, I would say you should always have a full copy, but that's for Howard Center staff.
And again, only Howard Center staff. For tracking purposes, you should make sure Betsy Kane knows that you went to a meeting. So it's either copying page 4 or using, I don't know if she put, there is, this, again, this is only Howard Center. There's a tracking sheet that you can say you went to a meeting and when you went to it, and this can go to Betsy Kane also. So she tracks all the meetings that we went to here. Yeah.
If we're in a meeting for a kid who's not a Howard Center client,
The other piece, and I said this was my New Year's resolution, but I think I said that last year. There is an Act 264 evaluation form. I have not seen it used a lot. I have seen it used sometimes. Again, this is part of this family voice. This is a way for them to parents to reflect on what they thought about the process. I encourage you to try it, see what you think. If it doesn't work for you, that's okay too. But it is part of the Act 264 paperwork that we offer. And then I think the last part is just reviewing the plan annually or as needed. If you don't need to review it in a year, fine. If you do and you want to check, use it as a kind of check-in for your team, that's fine too.
Normal, I went to an Act 264 meeting 2 weeks ago, and the team came out of it and said, let's regroup in 2 weeks. Which, I mean, we agreed to, but
yeah.
It felt like that, I mean, based on what you're saying, I wouldn't necessarily expect that that's...
I think usually you should leave a meeting with a meeting date. If people are feeling urgency, I mean, you're not going to have much movement usually in any referrals in 2 weeks. I would say meet in about a month or so, 6 weeks. Some teams want to meet sooner, do a check-in. Maybe there's a lot going on for that kid.
But that's what the team, the treatment team, the team that was at the Act 264 meeting.
Because if I'm going to a meeting as a consultant, I'm not going to come back in 2 weeks. Because it's really about the team checking in and figuring out who's doing what and checking in about that. Mm-hmm. So no, it does not, people certainly will invite you and you can say, I don't need to be at that follow-up.
But you can just give them the information.
Correct.
And yeah, I've got them on the list for X and it should start.
Right. So that's the paperwork. Anybody have any questions about that? Or running the meeting? Or okay. So the next part is just talking about when might people talk about LIT, so the local interagency team. So this is the team that meets monthly here at Howard Center. It has providers from education, mental health, adoption, substance abuse, DCF. So this is when you have an Act 264 meeting, and there are barriers to implementing the plan, such as like significant funding barriers, or they really wanted to try something creative and there was an idea of like, what about some kind of creative shared parenting something? Might be a time to kind of bring it to a larger team. Or sometimes there's disagreement, like half the team really thinks this needs to be a residential placement request and half the team is like, no, here's what we think. Might be a time to go to LIT. What you should do in any of those instances is first talk with your supervisor. So talk through the supervisor. Oftentimes, things can be resolved at the team or kind of local level and doesn't need to go up to LIT. If it does, you would usually kind of pull me in. I am one of the LIT members. And you would pull in probably Betsy Kane, who's the LIT coordinator. So some kind of examples have been, again, a kid needs to go to a specialized residential treatment facility. People are not budging on that request and hold firm to, I will not try community services. Might be a time for some larger body to weigh in on that. Sometimes there's complicated systems things, like DCF is involved, mental health is involved, developmental services is involved, and it's like all these different people, who can pay for what? That might be a time to bring it to LIT as well. If things can't be resolved at LIT, it moves on to SIT, but that's something that Betsy Kane, who coordinates that, would manage all of that. Any questions? It doesn't happen that often. I will tell you, as a member of LIT, LIT gets canceled a lot. And I actually think that that's a good thing. I don't think that that's a bad thing. I think that our community in general does a really nice job at problem solving at the local level. Supervisors are involved, I'm involved, Betsy Kane's involved, and we often work through things so they don't, there's not disagreement or there's not funding barriers. That kind of thing. So talk a little bit then about what I do. So here in Chittenden County, I am the intensive services coordinator. I work for Howard Center and NFI, and I am the liaison with the Department of Mental Health. So I am the clinical consultant, and I also do a bit of
kind of like a centralized intake if people are wanting residential or any of our higher level mental health services. So again, if you have a case that's like kind of stuck at the Act 264 level, people are not really feeling like we're answering the right questions or they need more, you talk with your supervisor and you'd probably pull me into the meeting. So I would come to the Act 264 meeting. So I can only do referrals for kids who are not in DCF custody. There's DCF money and there's mental health money. I can't make any decisions around DCF money. I can make recommendations. Anyone can come to me and talk through cases with me, but I can only make referrals for non-DCF custody kids. So I am happy to consult on any and all service questions or community level kind of questions and referrals. I specifically kind of have to be involved if we're talking about any services at NFI. Those are considered all intensive higher level services, and then any residential placements I have to be a part of, and I have to be in that discussion. And then also here at Howard Center, we have our own waiver level high intensive community services, our EFT program that Michelle's a part of, that I have to be a part of all of those referrals as well. I also, once kids are in those services, I stay connected to kind of help with how that's going, tracking the progress, and then discharge planning out of it. So my email and my phone are on there. Even if you call my desk phone here at Howard Center, it's going to go to my cell phone. So you can just save yourself time and just call my cell phone directly because I'm not sitting there often. Vanessa.
So if we're before the meeting, if we're thinking about like a referral to an intensive community services, like would we call you into the Act 264 or would we just
yes.
talk to you afterwards?
You'd call me into the Act 264. I'd have to be there. I go to a lot of Act 264s. I don't have to go to all of them. There is a perception that I have to be invited to every Act 264. That is not true. If you are thinking or your team is stuck and you're wondering about higher level services, I have to say, even if a parent says, I just want him to go to residential, let's talk about that. Like, I'd like to get ahead of it rather than when they're like really kind of in the depths of like, that's what we need. Like, let me get ahead of it and kind of say, here's actually what I'd recommend instead. I'm happy to come to the meeting or kind of consult with you around what I might say at the meeting if I can't go. Yeah. If it's definitely going on a residential track, then I have to come and I have to be at the meeting. And that's when you can't have a meeting without me. So you might need to like book it out a little bit. Yeah. So again, just for the residential referral process, if the kid is not in DCF custody, I have to be involved. That's when you're doing the rest of the packet. But I will be doing the whole packet with you. You're not on your own. I'll be in the meeting with you, probably facilitating it with you. If DCF has custody of the child, they have their own process. So they will be doing all of their own paperwork and working with their supervisors around that.
Jess, does this process and your involvement, is it the same if a child has private insurance versus Medicaid, or is this?
So any higher level services requires Medicaid, but I'm happy to come to a meeting and talk that through. There's two kinds of Medicaid, so it's possible that the kid could get Katie Beckett Medicaid, which is needs-based Medicaid versus income-based Medicaid. So I could be there to kind of talk through that process as well. So yeah, definitely. So the residential referral process, I won't really spend a lot of time on this. This is really just sections 2 and 3. It has another bunch of releases and it has a bunch of other questions for the team. If you're doing this, I'll be sitting there next to you, so we will do it together. And that's kind of it. Oh, there is one other sheet. There's one other handout that just gives you a little more information about my job and who I am. There's only one of me in the state, so that's why it's kind of novel, I think. But it talks to you a little bit about higher level services and the eligibility for that. But if you're questioning this, call me anytime. It's my job.
So there isn't a you in Addison County or Washington
There are people
County.
That do similar jobs. But they might just kind of hold residential cases versus I do a lot of consultation and go to meetings and kind of sort things out so they don't. LITs are used a lot more in other parts of the state, like a lot more. In some parts of the state, every residential request has to go through LIT, and that is not at all how we practice here because they go through me. So it's just different. Yeah. Yeah, no, please.
Once it's decided what services the child get based on the meeting, who then notifies the members of the meeting?
which ones were approved and which ones weren't approved.
So it would be kind of who's identified as a point person in that section one. So say a kid, I'll use an example. Like, so say a I went to a meeting and I said, yeah, I think this kid qualifies for EFT. So I would be working in coordination with that program to do that referral. So the so I would be checking in with whoever is the case manager on that team around the status of that. Or say it's for an IFBS referral. Whoever made that referral would be the one that's, again, identified on the thing as the point person to check in about the status of that. So.
And sometimes you have to follow, like, if you're from education and you want to know, like, oh, did that IFBS referral go in?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you do have to kind of reach out to people, hey, what's the status of this?
Right.
Did this actually happen? Because it's pretty uncommon, I would say, that all those different people, like, they would be like, oh, I did what I was supposed to do, and then they reach out to everyone on the Act 264 and say,
right.
Oh, just want you to know, you did this. Like, that doesn't often happen.
Right. Right. Well, and that's why when everybody gets a copy, you see who's identified. And if your team is meeting regularly, which they should, you're all saying, hey, remember this document? You made that referral. What's going on with it? And that person's checking in. Oh, you guys are good. Please remember to fill out your evaluations. Are there any questions I didn't cover? People feel comfortable? Like, you can go out in the world, you can do this? I think so. Thanks, everyone. You can leave your evaluations on the back page, or the back table. Back page. All right.